fashioned us from the dust. And since our existence, there's only been one mission: for you to commune with us. And then came the garden, we became the fallen. Sin made us lose our way. Oh, but the love that's too good to give up set a course for amazing grace. This is the gospel, this is the good news. Tell everybody how he saved you. This is the gospel, come hear the good news. Tell everybody there's a God that loves you. Oh, how he loves you. There's a God that loves you. Oh, how he loves you. There's a God that loves you. Then came the Savior, was born in a manger, raised up to ransom us. Healing the blind, raising dead back to life, all the signs of his perfect love. And there on the cross, how he paid every cost, he defeated death, hell, and grave. And on that third morning, the stone started rolling. Oh, what a beautiful day. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Tell everybody how he saved you. This is the gospel. Come hear the good news. Tell everybody there's a God that loves you. Oh, how he loves you. There's a God that loves you. Oh, how he loves you. There's a God that loves you.
Go first.
Ooh, Lord.
God is a good God.
Yes, he is.
God is a good God.
Yes.
God is a mighty God.
Yes, he is.
God is a great God.
Yes, he is.
God is a loving God.
Oh, yes, he is.
He's a kind God. Anybody thankful to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Can you shout hallelujah all over this room? Say, God, I just thank you, Lord. I thank you for grace. I thank you for mercy. I thank you for allowing me to see another day. Turn to the person next to you and say, the Lord's been good to me. The Lord's been kind to me. And as we are entering in this season of greater, hey, I'm looking forward to the Lord blowing my mind because he's done it before and I know he'll do it again. Can you clap your hands all over this room this morning? Let me see. We're going to sing a new song this morning, but it's real simple. I will bless your name. I will give you praise. I will clap my hands. I will do my dance. Everybody say, I will bless.
I will bless your name.
For the rest of my life, I'll give you.
I will give you praise.
I will clap my hands.
I will clap my hands.
I will do my dance. Cause you've been good, you've been kind, everybody, you've blown my mind. That no one could close. Have you seen him? You keep making ways when there's no way. Everybody, you have opened.
You have opened doors
that no man could close.
That no one could close.
And I keep watching you make ways.
When there seems no way.
Every breath I take, I'm gonna bless your name. Anybody came in here today to bless the Father? Every move I make, every breath I take, I'm gonna bless your name. Everybody sing one more thing.
Every move I make,
every breath I take,
every breath I take,
I'm gonna
bless your name.
I said, yes, I will. Every move I make,
every move I make,
every breath I take,
I'm gonna bless your name.
Let's sing that again. Every move I make, say.
Every move I make.
Every breath
I take, I'm gonna bless your name.
I will lift you up. I will lift you up. that he's been good. He's been kind. And he didn't have to. He's been good. He's been kind. He's been good. He's been good. He's been kind. Can you stretch your hands to the Father and say, Lord, I thank you. He's been kind.
He's been kind.
Oh, he's been good. He's been kind.
He's been kind.
He's been good.
He's been good.
He's been kind.
He's been kind.
And in this next season, he's been
good.
He's been kind.
He's been kind.
You blow my mind.
Thank you, Jesus. There is absolutely nothing that we could ever do to deserve the blessings that he bestows upon us day after day. Nothing. But he's still been good, and he's still been faithful, even in all of our mess, our mess ups, our hang ups. He still never fails us. And he continues to be good because he just is good. It's in his nature. We are grateful people this morning, so we say, Lord, you are good. You've been so good. Lord, you are good. You've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. I can't even if I try, you've been,
yes,
so good. Oh, you've been oh so good. Oh, you've been so good. Thank you. Say that I've been blessed because you've been. When I didn't deserve it, you've been. I didn't earn it, but you've been. So good. And you are so good. To me. Come on, let's move on. God has smiled on me. He has set me free. Can we lift that up, church? Say, God has, every day of my life,
smiled on me.
He has set me. Lift up a praise in the room. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
He's been good. He's been real good. He's been better than good. He's been better to me than I've been to. Y'all know he's been good. I know a book that says, I would have lost heart if I had not seen the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Another scripture says that goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Does anybody feel the goodness of God? Do you feel the goodness of God? Even at your lowest low, even at your highest high, It ain't nothing if you cannot feel the goodness of God. Let's pray together. So many doors you've opened. So many ways you've made. God, so many times you've healed me. God, so many doors you've closed. So many doors you've closed. So many ways I was trying to make. And you said, that ain't the way. So many times, God, I wanted healing to look like this. But God, you said healing was gonna look like that. But God, we thank you that no matter what good looks like, you are good. You are kind. You are love. And so God, we stand here in this moment thanking you for the Spirit of God that is in this place even now. Thanking you, God, for the songs that have been sung, the hands that have been raised, the hearts that have been lifted. But God, somebody here is needing a healing. Somebody here is needing a miracle. Somebody here is needing to feel your presence in a way they have never felt it before. Somebody needs strength to go on a little bit longer. Somebody needs to know that they can run on and see what the end is gonna be. God, somebody here today is praying to conceive. Somebody here is praying to get through the week. Somebody's praying to get through the semester. It's me, oh Lord. It's somebody else too, God. Somebody is praying just to not cuss somebody out. But so many doors you've opened and so many ways you've made. So God, we say thank you in advance for the ways that you're gonna make, the healing that you're gonna send, the deliverance that is on the way. God, we thank you that we're gonna run on and see what the end is gonna be. God, we thank you for the success. We thank you for the healing. We thank you for this service. We thank you for your Spirit. God, we thank you that you are good and that we get to see the goodness of God here in the land of the living. Bless us in this service now. Hear our heart, oh God. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God said amen.
Come on, let's give God some praise. We can do better than that. She prayed us into our victory. We're grateful this morning for each of you. The psalmist said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. How many of you glad to be here this morning? How many of you glad that God gave you another opportunity to worship his Son, our Savior, in spirit and in truth? We're grateful this morning that you chose to worship with us here at St. John's downtown. We recognize that you passed by many churches on your way here, but the fact that you chose this as your place of worship, we are so grateful this morning. Would you show God some love for our pastor this morning in her absence? I know she's watching. Can you just send a hello this morning? We're praying for you. We love you. We miss you this morning. Get well. All of our first-time visitors, would you please stand, first-time visitors? Do we have any first-time visitor in the house? Amen. We're grateful for you this morning. And if you are a first-time guest, first-time visitor, we have a gift for you in the Touchpoint Connect Center. See us immediately after worship and we'll get you your gift. We're grateful that you're here this morning and we pray that the experience is enriching for you. We want to invite everybody to come out this Saturday for volunteer appreciation for all of our volunteers who give your time, your talent, your effort so selflessly every Sunday. Come out Saturday and volunteer at the Bread of Life. It's a wonderful opportunity for you to connect with us, to find out what we're doing, to meet the needs of the community. And so please, we want to honor you on Saturday. Wear your t-shirts, and if you don't have a t-shirt, you can get one in the Touchpoint Connect Center. Amen. There are so many things happening here on the campus, and so we're grateful this morning to have with us Pastor Stephanie Wilkins, and Stephanie is going to come up and introduce our guest this morning. Give God some praise for Pastor Stephanie. wears a lot of hats in the life of the church, but she's being political this morning.
Yes, I am. Thank you, thank you. Well, we say political, it plays out in the political arena, but it's a moral issue. Either we're doing things God's way or we're doing it our own way. And our own way don't work, okay? So I am pleased to acknowledge Molly Cook, who is a candidate for Senate District 15. Would you show her some love?
Amen, amen, amen.
So I've got to let you know, she will be in the back in the Touchpoint Center if you want to learn more information. But what's most important, whoever it is you're going to vote for, you need to know that there is a special election May the 4th. May the 4th, the day before Cinco de Mayo. You can celebrate Cinco de Mayo by voting on May the 4th. Then you got to come back again for the special runoff, which will be May the 28th. Am I right? May the 28th. You say, well, my vote don't matter. Well, you do understand that is why there are those in power who are fighting us so hard, because your vote does matter.
Amen.
So you need to get up, get out, and vote. Take somebody with you, please. Give somebody a ride. But we're thankful for you coming. Get out and vote. What are the two dates? May the
4th
and May the 20th. Thank you. We love you.
God bless you. You sound like you're running for office. Amen. We give God some praise for Pastor Stephanie this morning. Molly, we're lifting you up. Ursula Williams. Ursula Williams, come on. She's going to talk to us about the women's Bible study. Give God some praise for her. She comes in her own way.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Pastor Rick, you're going to stop butchering my name. Ursula. Hey, ladies. We will be restarting our Bible study this Saturday on the 20th at 10 o'clock. We will be starting a new Bible study series called When You Pray. It is a 7-session women's Bible study at 10 o'clock virtually. You should have received a text probably about 5 minutes ago. It is called When You Pray. It is an invitation to start praying virtually with us. Please check it out. Everyone should have received a text. It is just exploring different ways to pray. So please check it out at 10 o'clock. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you, Ursula. God bless you. Appreciate you so much. How many of you know this morning that God is a God of first chance? He's a God of second chance. He's a God of the third chance. He's a God of the slim chance, the fat chance, and also the no chance. We have a short video that we want to show you real quick this morning, a portion of a video, and then we're going to bring to the stage Danny Sneed. Let's roll that video.
Second chances, they're the heartbeat of the gospel. And the second chances given to me are the reason I'm here today.
This is Jermaine Wilson. He's the mayor of Leavenworth.
I knew I recognized
him. Hey, man, how you doing?
Leavenworth mayor.
Growing up, I was exposed to crime at an early age. I began to use drugs so I can hang out with the older kids. My dad had been to prison. My siblings had been to prison. With my drug use and criminal activities, I also ended up in prison. While I was in my prison cell, room 507, I cried out to God. I said, Lord, I need you in my life. And I had a son who needed his father. He was 8 months old. I accepted Christ and I became free. The prison fellowship program helped me and taught me to unlearn those negative things that I had learned. Angel Tree was able to come beside me and provide a gift to my son.
Angel Tree helped him to be there, kind of in a physical sense, even though he wasn't able to be. It just helped us know that he was still a part, and it meant a lot for him as a dad.
When I was released from prison, I faced two main challenges that every returning citizen faces: housing and employment. Landlords wouldn't rent to me because I had a criminal record. Employers didn't hire me because I had a criminal record. Trying to obtain my driver's license was challenging as well. I eventually found the job, an hour away from my house, but when my ride failed through one time, I was fired on the spot, even though I paid my debt to society and felt like I was still serving time. The church, it became my re-entry. I'll never forget when I walked in the sanctuary, church members, they embraced me. It was the love that they shared with me that made me feel welcome. They
give God some praise. That's not the whole story, y'all, but we wanted you to know that we have a ministry here at St. John's that is meeting the needs of those who are returning citizens. Give God some praise for Danny.
First, give honor to God. After 26 years of incarceration, I met a brother in prison who told me, Danny, when you get out, go to St. John's. And that was in 2008. And St. John's, like that church, opened their doors and gave me a second chance. But what I did with that second chance, I got involved. And we have a ministry here that addresses second chances, Path of Freedom Ministry. We meet every Thursday from 5:30 to 6:30. We got these push cars if you want to get involved. This church is leading the nation in second chances. April is second chance month, but we didn't wait to April. Yeah. We've been doing this for over a decade. Thank you.
God bless you. Thank you, Danny. Appreciate the work that you're doing, and we're so grateful. At this time, Pastor Tahita is going to come up, and she's going to share with us some information on how we can support the mission and the work of ministry. Give God some praise for her as she comes in on way.
Thank you. Hey, good morning. Rodney Owens also asked me to let you know about Cocaine Anonymous, Alcohol Anonymous. If you'd like to meet, they meet on Wednesdays. 6:30. You know what it is. You know what you want and you don't want. How do I know? Because I stand here as a recovered addict. Y'all act like y'all didn't know that. Look at God, how he'll clean you up, pick you up, turn you all the way around. Make it look like you never been there. I'm just going to put it out there. You know what it is. Want your life back? Go to the meeting. That's all I'm going to tell you. All right? Hey, y'all, it's offering time. Hey, it's offering time. If God's been good to you, and I mean really good to you. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. I'm going to change it a little bit. Tahitarize it a little bit. And I want you to say it with me. For God so loved me. For God so loved. Come on, you can do it. For God so loved that he gave. All right, we're going to stop right there. The question is, what are you giving? What are you giving that's reminiscent of a tangible form that God can use to move his kingdom forward? What are you giving? This is offering time. This is your reasonable portion to be able to give with a cheerful heart. And so what I'm asking you to do today is to search inside and ask, God, what do you want me to give? The Bible says 10%. But who knows? The Holy Spirit might tell you today to give 15% so that he can bless you all the more. I want you to remember that ask God, God, what do you want me to give today? The baseline is 10%. But how many of you know that if God asks you to give 10%, he gonna do far more and exceedingly above all that you could ever ask or think, according to his riches in glory. God's riches are way better than anything we could ever describe as being rich. So you have ways that you can give. They're on the screen. I love the, you know, for our older saints that still write checks, you can send your tithe into St. John's Downtown, 2019 Crawford, Houston, Texas, 77002. That's your way to do it, all right? Then, for all you new technology folk, you know, y'all Cash App and DoorDash, y'all Cash Apping your partners, y'all Cash Apping using that for your kids. You can also use Cash App for your tithes, just in case you didn't know. I'm trying to help somebody. Oh, Zelle. Oh, the Holy Spirit told me to share this with you. If you use Cash App, that's the way you can keep a record of what you've given to the church. And then next year when it's tax time, you already got your record. Just a little information, just for sharing. For Zelle, you can do Zelle. You can also give online with stjohnsdowntown.org. But just know this. However you choose to give, you're sowing into a ministry that you know we help people. If you don't know, come by here on the third Saturday. You're going to see what's happening here. And so, you know, Pastor Tiff don't drive no Rolls Royce, Bentley. You know, she ain't flying the helicopter across the city. And that's no shade to anybody that can do that. That's not what it's about. It's about the divine assignment that God has for this campus. All right? And you are part of it. And so I thank God for your giving. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, you gave us the greatest gift that was ever created in the form of Jesus Christ. But then, God, you also gave us the opportunity to give back to you with a cheerful heart. And so, God, during this offering moment, our prayer, God, is that you would bless our offering, that you would bless us as the givers and the partakers and the overseers over the blessing that you have so freely given to us. God, we thank you that whether we have a little or a lot, we can take our measurement in the fact that we have the God that will open up the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing that we don't have room enough to receive. And so, God, in this moment, we put our faith and our trust in the fact and the promise that we are blessed to be a blessing. Thank you for calling us your own. It is in the name that is above every other name. It is in the name that provides, that heals, that calms, that soothes. It is in the name of Jesus, the Christ, that we pray. And if you believe that God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you could ever ask or think, I want you to shout hallelujah. And thank you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Amen. Come on, keep clapping those hands. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on, anybody believe that God's going to do something big in your life? Come on, if you're ready for it, if you're excited about it, come on. You ought to get up on your feet right there. You ought to stretch your hands towards heaven. God, I'm waiting on it. God, I'm ready for it. I know that you're going to do it for me. Come on. You are not a man that you would lie. Come on, anybody believe that today? Come on, hallelujah.
See, I believe, say that it's my season.
It's my season.
Come on, do you really believe that today?
Say, I believe.
Tell them.
Say that it's my time.
It's my time.
It's my time.
It's my time.
And I can feel it.
I can feel it.
Everybody say breakthrough. It is in the room.
Breakthrough's in the room.
Yeah. Anticipating.
Anticipating.
Come on, what are you anticipating? I know that God's going to do it. Say,
God's getting ready to move.
Come on, that's our declaration today. Come on, stand up on your feet right there. Say, for. Say,
for I know my God is worth a miracle.
Just for who?
Just for me.
Raise your worship up, say.
And it's gonna be. Yeah.
Come on, get up on your feet right there. Come on, start a watch party online. Come on, right there. If you're at your cubicle, if you're at your desk, tell them right there. Yeah, it's gonna be big.
It's gonna be.
Yep. Come on, I serve a big, big God. Come on, he can do nothing, come on, but exceed my expectations. Come on, tell him right there. Say, God's gonna.
God's gonna open the windows of heaven.
I said, pour me.
Pour me out a blessing.
Won't be safe.
Won't be room to contain.
Can't even try.
Won't even try.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's gonna be great.
Say, God's about to blow my mind. Say,
God's about to blow my mind.
Come on, let's go back to the top right there. Everybody say, see, I believe.
Season.
Come on, you really got to believe that over your own life. Say,
I believe.
Say that it's my time.
It's my time.
It's my time.
It's my time.
Oh, I can feel it.
I can feel it.
Everybody say breakthrough. It is in the room.
Breakthrough.
Yeah.
Anticipated.
Everybody, God's getting ready to stand up on your feet. Say, for I know.
For I know my God is worth a miracle.
Just for whose sake?
Just for me.
And it's going to be big.
It's gonna be
raise up.
Big.
Come on. Turn your worship up in this room. Come on. God loves you. Come on. He's excited about your future. And it's going to be big.
It's going to be big.
Come on. We know that. Come on. We're expecting that. Come on. Get out of the way right there. Come on. Get that watch party started. Come on. See, God's going to.
God's going to open the windows of heaven.
I said,
pour me. Pour me out of heaven.
Won't be sad.
Won't be rules to contain.
Can't even try.
Won't even try to escape.
Yeah.
It's going to be big.
God's about to blow my mind. Say.
God's about to blow my mind.
Let's do it again. Come on. See, God's going to.
God's going to.
I said,
open the windows of heaven.
Worship up in this room, come on. And it's gonna be
big.
And it's about to be big.
Big.
Lord, won't you let it be big?
Big.
Tell your neighbor, be big.
Big.
And it's gonna be
big.
God's about to blow my mind, say.
God's about to blow my mind.
Come on, right there, say. Say, God's gonna.
God's gonna open the windows of heaven.
I said,
pour me.
Say,
out of heaven.
God's gonna
open the windows of heaven.
mouth in this room said over your own life. Won't be safe. Can't even try. Yeah, 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 yeah. God's about to blow my mind.
Y'all believe it's about to be big. If you believe everybody's standing for you, I want y'all to just go back to that part, because we got, it's breakthroughs in the room right now, because y'all, some of y'all sitting on y'all blessings. So come on, Chauncey, let's go to the throne. Come on, tell them again. It's going to be big.
Open the windows. I said, pour me
out.
God is going to. I said, pour me. God is going to. I said, pour me. About to blow my mind, say.
God's about to blow my mind.
God bless you real good.
Now, how many of y'all believe that? Give God a big praise in this house. Come on, God's about to blow your mind, baby. He can't blow it if you don't give him praise. Your breakthrough is in your praise.
Yeah.
Your deliverance is in your praise.
Yeah.
Your healing is in your praise. Your joy is in your praise. It's going to be clear. Some praise in this house. Those on white line drinking coffee, God is about to do something big. Those eating Cheerios right now, God says he's about to blow your mind. If you believe God's going to do something big, clap your hands, all you people. Shout to the Lord with the voice of praise. Give God some praise in this house right now. God's about to open the windows of heaven and pour out so much blessing. Give God some praise for the praise team. Give God some praise for the band. And let the people of God say amen. It is great being with you in worship on this second Sunday after Easter, or Resurrection Sunday. Give God some praise for folks who are watching online. We thank God for you. I thank God for my beautiful wife. Give it up for Jeanette Elaine Bowie. Good having my baby in the house. When she's here, I preach better, her and the Holy Ghost, amen? Amen. Last week, Pastor Juanita preached a powerful message here, and she kicked off our sermon series, Pastor Rick, entitled Divine Encounters. Yeah. Has anybody ever had a divine encounter where God showed up and blew your mind? That's about 38% of y'all, so guess what? For the next few weeks, we're going to be talking about divine encounters, discovering how one encounter can change your life. Man, I just love that Pastor Mike song. That's my song. Pastor Mike wrote that song. Because God said, I'm going to do something big in your life. I'm going to let you have a divine encounter and spiritual transformation, and say it's going to be big. Throughout this series, our prayer is that you recognize your divine encounter and apply it to your life to experience transformation and greater. Say greater. Greater. Remember, this year in 2024, we want more. Yeah. And say greater is coming. Greater. Nudge your neighbor, say greater is coming. Now, with greater, I got a long passage up, so I'm going to bless y'all today. Sit on down. And we're going to read 20 verses. I got to lay it out because it's going to be big. Yeah, 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 yeah. The more the scripture, the more the blessing. So, Acts chapter 9, verse 1. Hear these words called Saul's conversion. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. Y'all can read with me. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus so that he could find anyone there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly, a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting." He replied, "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what to do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days, say 3 days, he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with the authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go, this man, my chosen instrument, to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you was coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with" what? "The Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized. After taking some food, he regained his strength. Several days with the disciples in Damascus. That Jesus is the Son of God. Y'all, the word of God for the people of God. May the people of God say amen. Man, I love this story, and I just want to share with y'all this morning. The praise team has set it up. The Holy Ghost is in the house. I wanted to share with y'all and encourage you all that something good is about to happen. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, oh neighbor, do you not know that something good is about to happen?" Now, that neighbor ain't smiling, but say, "Neighbor, hear me, neighbor." Say, "Neighbor, do you not know that something good is about to happen?" Say, "Let's see, let's see, let's see, let's see, let's see." God, we thank you right now with the hand clap saying that something good is already happening. Because God, you woke us up this morning and you started us on our way. You gave us brand new mercies that are new every morning. So God, preach this word, speak to our hearts, and let us know that something good is about to happen in this place right now. In Jesus' name, Amen. If you believe something good is about to happen, give the Lord some praise right now. About 2 weeks ago, we celebrated a man who stole the keys from death and the grave. He suffered on the cross all day Friday, all day Saturday, but early Sunday morning, Jesus got up from a borrowed tomb with all power in his hands to heal our hurts, to heal our habits, to heal our hangups, to heal our heartaches, and even to heal our hiccups. This Jesus. God raised him from the grave to tell people who were on the way. The way were people who had been converted to follow Jesus. They were on the way, and he came back to tell the people on the way, you've been struggling long enough, and regardless of your tests, trials, and tribulations, get ready. He told us to the devil, get ready for something good is about to happen. And some of y'all right here, you're looking at me like I'm cross-eyed and crazy right now. Some of y'all not with me. And somebody probably saying, well, Dr. Bowie, how can something good happen to me right now? I know I'm rolling down your alley right now. When I don't have financial resources, how can good something happen to me right now? And right now, how can something good happen to me when I'm addicted? Well, Tahita gave us some good news today. And when you're addicted, Jesus can heal the addicted. How can something good happen when I'm lonely, busted, and disgusted and can't be trusted? How can something good happen to me? The mere fact God woke you up this morning and started you on your way is the first step to let you know that God is up to something and something good is about to happen. If you believe that, give God some praise, a good, good praise, for something good is about to happen. Well, for those who are with me this morning, this text teaches us that something good can happen, beloved, but you must first understand, hear me this morning, that God will go to the extreme to get your attention. Come on, help us, Holy Ghost. You must understand that God will go to extreme measures for those whom God loves. If God has a purpose and plan for your life, God will go to the pits of hell so that you can experience what God has for your life. Now, in the text, there was a man named Saul from Tarsus. He was a Hellenistic Jew, and he was very religious. He was zealous, and he was a trained Pharisee. Saul knew the law. He knew the Torah backwards and forth, and he believed that this new movement called the Way was a direct threat to Judaism. Saul proclaimed Caesar as Lord. And he said, no, Jesus is not Lord. So therefore, in Saul's mind, he thought that what he was trained to do, he was doing right and God was being honored. Have you ever believed in something so wrong and to find out you was wrong as two left shoes? I know there's been times that I just knew I was doing right. Sometimes you can be doing wrong and wrong will feel right and you think you're doing the right thing. Am I talking to the right people this morning? As Saul was traveling on the road to Damascus going north about 150 miles from Jerusalem, he was on his way to persecute and torment people from St. John's. I mean, people from the Way. Saul did this consistently. And y'all, guess what? The Lord allowed Saul to do it. And finally, one day, God had enough. Say, had enough. And God said, I'm going to step in. And Saul was overwhelmed with the supernatural light and knocked him off his high horse. See, sometimes God has to knock you off your high horse to let you know that you ain't running nothing. Nudge your neighbor, say, you ain't running nothing. You got to get off your high horse. And it was something about Saul experiencing a life experience somewhat like an eclipse. Y'all remember the eclipse? Yeah. Oh, man. Look at that. That thing looked very scary. Celestial, but kind of eerie. And Saul began to see something like that. And before you know it, he was on the ground, and then it looked like this. Dark, real dark. And Saul didn't know what was going on. And some of y'all right now, just like Saul said, how can I be on the ground when I was doing the right thing? God said, you was doing the right thing, but for the wrong reason. And some of y'all right now, what you're going through doesn't make sense right now, but God has allowed you to go through extreme seasons of darkness, and it feels like your life has been eclipsed. Am I talking to the right people this morning? If you can't say amen, say ouch, man. God has you going through an eclipse to get your attention and let you know, just like that eclipse, Monica, just like this eclipse, God said, it won't last always. Regardless how dark it may be in your life, my brother, that eclipse was real dark right now. But what I love about this eclipse, the light and the sun still illuminates over it. Whatever you're going through today, beloved, guess what? It's only temporary, and it won't last always. This darkness that you are dealing with is just preparation, beloved, for something greater. Say something greater. From this divine encounter, Saul lost his sight for 3 days. Say 3 days. And in those 3 days, God allowed scales to be on his eyes. Commentary said these scales represented spiritual blindness, and there was a veil over his understanding the truth that Jesus was truly the Messiah. So he had scales on his eyes, and God allowed Saul to be blind for 3 days. But in those 3 days, he was not just persecuting him, but he was perfecting his life. Three is a perfect number, a number of completion. So in these 3 days, God was perfecting him, and eventually he gave him a new vision. Say new vision. Helen Keller was once asked, what's the worst thing without having sight? She says it's to live with sight and have no vision. Take a picture of that. Put that on the gram and make it look good. Make it look good. Family, I'm convicted and convinced that God has allowed us to go through some extreme measures, not to take our sight, but to give us a brand new vision. Say new vision, new vision. Right now, some of us, we have scales on our eyes. Am I talking to the right people? You got scales on your eyes, and you can't see why you had to go through so much extreme drama, pain, and disappointment. But, beloved, I stop by to tell you, as I go to brunch, I'm a living witness that sometimes God will allow you to lose your sight to give you a brand new vision. Is there anybody in this room who lost their sight? But God has given you a fresh perspective on life. Unfortunately, some of y'all, you had to lose your house, you had to lose your spouse, you had to lose your job, and you almost lost your mind. But God said, you didn't lose them. I gave you a fresh vision. Say new vision. So thanks be to God for those sleepless nights. Thanks be to God for that foreclosure. Thanks be to God for that divorce. Thanks be to God for those lean financial seasons. For God was using those dark moments not to disappoint us or to deplete us, but God is using those dark moments to complete us. Once Saul encountered that extreme transformative light, he was soon to discover that in spite of his flaws, Chris, in spite of his flaws, God chooses to use the least likely people for God's purpose. It's right here in the text, y'all, verse 13 and 15. I can't read it all. We just read it all. Ananias, who was a disciple of Jesus, he knew all about Saul. Everybody knew about Saul. They saw it on the gram. They saw it on TikTok. They saw it on Facebook. Everybody knew about Saul. Saul was scared. Saul was kind of like, how would I be? He was kind of like crazy, like Donald Trump. And he had an attitude like Suge Knight. But he was smart like Dr. Mike Bowie. All that. And Ananias said, Lord, I got to bring this joke in my house. Y'all know this dude is crazy. Ananias said, everybody knew all about him. And Ananias began to question, God, why do you want to bring Saul in my presence so that we can take care of him? How often has we become like Ananias? That sometimes based on somebody's reputation and somebody's past, we begin to question if somebody is good enough, if somebody have what it takes. See, we must understand that every now and then, even though they knew Saul's past, God knew Saul's future. People may talk about your past, my brother. People know your past, but only God knows your future. Give God some praise for a brand new future and a brand new day. See, this is a clear reminder this morning, y'all, that God chooses to use the least likely and unexpected people for God's purpose. Moses had a speech impediment. David was an adulterer. Gomer was a prostitute. And Peter was a cusser. And if God can use Peter, Gomer, David, and Moses, surely God can use you too. Give God some praise, baby, because you're in that good number. This is a great reminder that when we are at our very worst, God is thinking about our very best. Let me say it again. When we are at our very worst, God is thinking about our very best. God can see what we can't see. I think Marvin Sapp says it better than Mike Bowie. He saw the when everyone else could only see the. Y'all better give Sapp some credit for that song. We can't put this on. But Marvin said that God sees our best. When other folk talk about our worst. When Ananias saw a murderer, God saw a man of God. When society saw a persecutor, God saw a powerful preacher. When people see you as trash, God sees you as a powerful treasure. The good news is this morning, God doesn't see our inabilities. God doesn't see our capabilities, but God just needs our availability. Is there anybody here available for God today for God to do something big? God doesn't care if you can't dot an I or cross a T. God says, baby, you just show up and watch me show out. Say it's gonna be big. When people find out how God has transformed you, they'll talk about what you used to be and where you used to go and what you used to do, what you used to do. But you can tell them with deep conviction, I don't know why God did it, but I'm so glad God did, because it's but by His grace, I'm not what I used to be. But thank God, by the power of the Holy Ghost, I'm not what I'm gonna be. If you're glad that God did it because you didn't deserve it, know that God says, I have you right where you need to be. I don't know why God did it, but all I know, y'all, right now, because we're still here, something good is about to happen. I'm about to turn the corner. We're about to get up out of here. I see y'all getting ready to eat those pancakes. But once God chose and commission Saul, God will use people and community to bless you. You can't do this by yourself. I don't care how anointed you are. I don't care where you went to school. I don't care if you live in a gated community. God says you can't do this by yourself. When Ananias laid hands on Saul's eyes, he was delivered from a spiritual blindness, and he was filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, and he got connected to community. Once the scales fell off his eyes, he discovered that God had intentionally organized a village around him that allowed him to live on kingdom purpose and with a kingdom attitude. When I think about how God began to make a way, did you see that brother on that video? This brother was in jail. He was locked down from people, but he wasn't locked out of God's grace. Do you know grace can go behind prison doors? Do you know grace can go behind anything? So grace showed up, and the guy who was once a prisoner, now he's the mayor of Leavenworth, Kansas. You can't tell me what God can't do. If he did it for him, surely God will do it for you. As a village, we have to be like that community we saw in a video. We have to come around that brother and that sister and make sure that the scales have been removed from their eyes so they can see their brand new future filled with hope. Who is in your community? Who prays for you and not prays on you? When you get blessed, do they rejoice with the Lord with you, or do they hate on them? You don't need no haters with you, because you can hate all by yourself and you can do good all by yourself. Who's in your village? As they surrounded him, they removed the scales from his eyes. And I believe right now there's somebody in this room with scales still on their eyes. You can't even hear my sermon because you can't even see your future because your eyes are wide shut. But God has already positioned and handpicked the right people to help you walk you into your destiny. Yeah, y'all missed that. I don't care how far you've come. God said, I've already handpicked the right people to help you get to that place called there. You might be here, but he says, like the Staple Singers, I'm going to take you. I want to see if y'all still connected with me. There's something about connecting in the right community. You can't do this by yourself, but you need a community to walk alongside you and to encourage you, kind of like on a soul train line. Come here, Pastor Rick. Come here, Pastor Stephanie. See, God said every now and then, when you move fast, Pastor Stephanie, when you're down to nothing, God said, I'm going to send the cousins. I'm going to send goodness and mercy. Where mercy at? To follow me all the days of my life. Now, mind you, I just got my sight back, but they're going to help me get my vision. I don't know where I'm going, but they've been there and done that, and they have the T-shirt. They says, if God healed me from an addiction, surely God can heal you. So every now and then, I have to trust in the Lord and lean not to my own understanding. In all my ways, acknowledge him and them. And he's going to make my path straight. There's somebody right now with scales on your eyes. And you can't even see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I want you all to know that right now, God has positioned you, God has handpicked you, and God wants to do a miracle in your life. But who are you connected with? If you don't have a church home, God said there are some real people here at St. John's. We don't play. We ain't fake. We believe that God loves people even when they're down to nothing. God is always up to something. See, we're not trying to play church. We are the church. And God is saying, I need you to understand that even when you are at the lowest of your low, some good. I don't care how you feel. It ain't about your feelings. That's how God got up early Sunday morning, and he got up for your hangups. And God said, I rose for all your headaches. He said, I rose for all the haters. I rose so that you may have life and have it more abundantly. And if you believe that God has positioned you for something big, if you believe that God has a blessing and a miracle for you with your name on it, stand to your feet and give God a crazy praise in this house. I don't care. Hear me, I don't care. I don't care how it looks. I don't care how it smells. I don't care how it tastes. The mere fact you are still alive, some good is about to happen. If you believe that, give the Lord some praise right now. I don't need nobody moving. Don't try to beat the traffic. Nobody, don't try to beat the traffic. God was patient with you in your stinking sin. Nobody move. This is an important moment because somebody has scales on their eyes. This is serious right now. Somebody's ready to give up right now. But if you know that you thought you lost something, and God says, no, you didn't lose your sight, but I'm giving you a vision. If you feel like you lost a loved one, God say, no, you didn't lose your spouse. They left, but guess what? God say, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. If you know that God has given you a brand new vision, give God some praise in this house. Maybe, regardless of your flaws, people can talk about your flaws, but God would transform them into stars. People can talk about your hurt, but God can use that hurt for healing. If there's somebody here today wrestling with their flaws and feel like you're not good enough, God said, I came that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So if there's somebody here today who needs to know that something good is going to happen in your life, you've had seasons of disappointment, seasons of depression, and seasons of darkness and defeat. This is your day, beloved. Come on and receive what God has for you. The doors of the church are open. Clap your hands as they come. Clap your hands as they come. God's going to open up the windows of heaven. It won't be re-rotated. How many of you know God's going to blow your mind? God's going to do what?
God's about to blow my mind.
And what is your God going to do in the face of the devil? What is God going to do?
God's going to open the windows of heaven.
And do what?
Pour me out.
And what's going to happen?
Won't be wrong to
the you can't explain it.
Explain
come on, get your big
it.
Healing.
Yeah.
God's about to blow your mind. Come on, clap your hands. God's make that right now. What is God about to do? Blow their mind, God. Blow their mind, God. God, we thank you. God, we thank you. This is not entertainment. But God, we thank you right now. Regardless how loud or how soft we speak, God, you are moving right now. So Holy Spirit, remove the scales. Soften somebody's heart and heart so they will know when they get ready to leave this place that something good is about to happen. And when it happens, it's going to be big. Let that sister who's ready to give up, God say, don't give up. I believe in you. I died for you. I've given you resurrection power. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead is power in you. So get ready, because something good is about to happen. If you believe it and receive it, give the Lord some praise. Heaven's going to be big.
Come on, let's celebrate what God has done this morning through the preaching of the word. Can we give God some praise for the message this morning? Did you receive it? Did you believe it? Now let's give God some praise for the messenger. Dr. Bowie preached a powerful word this morning. If you made a decision for Christ, go to Touchpoint Connect Center. We want to continue to pray with you, continue to pray for you. If you're being baptized this morning, we want you to just come and sit on the first row. We're grateful that you have chosen to make this awesome step in your life. And also want to remind you that this Saturday is Distribution Saturday. Please come out and volunteer. We are so appreciative, so grateful for you this morning. Y'all know how we end it? We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Let's go ahead, Grace. We love you. There's nothing you can do about it.
Come on. See, God's gonna open the windows of heaven.
I said, pour me
out. God is gonna
open the windows of heaven.
I said, pour me
out.
God is gonna
open the windows of heaven.
I said, pour me
out.
God is gonna
open the windows of heaven.
I said, pour me
out.
God is gonna
open the windows of heaven.
I said,
Pour me out of bless. Won't be easy. Won't be room to contain.
Can't even try.
It's gonna be.
Yeah.